Hi there, I'm Alim and Karim, and today I'm going to talk about the database exam answers and strategies, and this will be the discussion about the exam. So here you are going to learn some tips and tricks, and this recording is very private. It will not be maybe trimmed or equalized or maybe cut it in many points or may not be edited. So you may hear some something like that, but you have to bear with me. It's almost 3 a.m. in the morning, but I have to make it anyway. If I don't make it, I will not make it anytime soon. So let's begin. So here is the SQL question that you have answered today. So the purpose of the question is to make you expert at SQL at every platform. So the question that's given in this paper is not really something that you could learn in 1 month. If you really practice SQL for, let's say, 1 or 2 years, then you will learn those stuff, or something you learn by experiment or experience. So the reason behind giving this hard question is so that you gain all the 1 year experience from that one exam. You maybe hate me from this exam that I'm so crucial and so brutal about that, but the funny thing about the exam, or the good thing about the exam, that you learn a lot. And from this video, it will be a piece of cake for you. So some of the things that I put in the exam that I have learned from my 8th grade or maybe 7th grade. So many of the things that I have learned by experiment or experience, you can say, because at my days, internet was not a very easy thing to gain, because there was no internet available. The things that I learned mostly from trial and error basis. So you'll find some of the questions that those are really not explained in any video or in any maybe tutorials, but it's really there, and you could learn it by having some hard experience the SQL. So, well, that being said, without further ado, let's jump into the question one. So it was really the first 40 marks was really very basic. You really have to know this, but some of those are still some confusing and very hard for you to understand, like 4 to 7. So we're going to go from the first one. So it was really asked to understand that when you have a gap, or if you have a keyword in a name, how can you call that name from your database? So let me get the text editor. That's a notepad 2. So the thing is, we could divide our databases to PLSQL, we write like this, which is actually the Oracle, or we could have the MySQL, and we could have Transact SQL, or the T-SQL, or you could say that MSSQL, which is Microsoft SQL Server, or Microsoft Access. So if I just put it below like this, and just Microsoft Access, or can I have, so something like that. So whatever code we write, it could be fall into in this three categories. So there are another database type which is called the PostgreSQL, and I haven't worked with it, so I can't give you some idea that how it works or what will the syntax in that. But once you get through this, many of the concepts will be very similar to those. But here in Oracle and T-SQL, when you have a keyword, or a space in a name, you should use third bracket to call it off. So it works like this, that select your table, so your column name is how you're doing, and next column is name date. That's it. So if you have a column name like name or date, you still have to use a third bracket, or else you'll get a syntax error, because name or the date is a keyword in many databases. So for Oracle or T-SQL, you have to use this third bracket. And if you use third bracket for every name, you are fine. So the convention is always put the third bracket when you are coding in T-SQL or PSSQL. From our table name is Hello World. That's it. So if you're in MySQL, it's different. For MySQL, you have to use the tilde sign. I call it the tilde sign. So you could find it before one. So if I just zoom in more, you'll see that this is called the tilde sign. It's not the first or single quote. It is the tilde sign. And you have to write the hello, sorry. So just copy paste to be more simple. And you have to again use the tilde sign. No single quote. The difference between the single quote and the tilde sign. So name, date, and you just place it with tilde sign. From our table name, it should be also with the tilde sign because it has a space in it. So that would be for MySQL. But I really don't ask you to write two syntaxes. Whatever you write, you just name the database name. That's it. So while one person was writing some in syntax, I asked him to write the database name, because in syntax differ from database to database. So let's see the in syntax. So if you have a string in database like PLSQL or TransactSQL rather than MySQL, you should treat it with a single quote. So whenever you have a string, you should treat it with single quote. Sorry, so I made another mistake. So if you are in TransactSQL, T-SQL, you should use single quote to determine any string character. But if you are in PLSQL, I could be wrong. If I am wrong, correct me. But as far as I remember, it should be the case. You should use double quote. So if it is not double quote, then it should be the single quote, but this could be the difference, but that's it. So in PSSQL or TNSSQL, for strings, you still have to put a quote. And for numbers, you should not put any quotes. That's the difference. When you are comparing number or saying something is number, you should not put a quote. If you put a quote, you will get a syntax error. So, but the difference is, if you have MySQL, it really treats differently. For MySQL, you could give a single quote to a number, you could single quote to a string. Everything is fine for MySQL. So, for the second answer, if we write that the select UID, so I'm saying that from table A, as far as I remember, so saying that use the in syntax and search for, so where UID in, so here it is number, so you just use without any quotation marks and in, and then I'm saying that a location. Get it just bigger. Question a little bit smaller. Okay, so sorry for that. So location in block one OC2. So that's it. So that would be for your SQL syntax, but and here I haven't specified any database name, so you could write either one of those. But if you're writing like this, should specify that it's MySQL. Or if you really think that your database supports for double quotes for string, you should write like this. But whatever it is, but the concept is you should not write or put a quotation in this numbers. That's the concept here. But for single database like MySQL, it's really different. Other than that, if you're not writing a syntax for MySQL, you should not put a single quote or double quote in front of the strings. That's the concept here. So in the third question, so maybe I have answered the third one. So yeah, third question is really similar to the second question. So where I just select a location. So you don't have to select all the columns when you're searching. You could select X column and search from Y column. That's really fine. So here, as you can see, that I'm selecting AOID, but I'm not, I'm selecting a location, but I'm not really searching from, okay, so here I'm searching from a location. Okay, so here I'm searching from AOID and a location, but I'm not selecting a location. So you can search from maybe XYZ, but you could only select a column. That's the concept. So these are really very basic SQL. You should know this. So here the question was a location. So the question is already written. Just let me go over that quick. These are very straightforward question. So maybe I messed up the numbers. So this one is the third one. So as you can see that a location in and same. So these two are very similar, and you should answer correctly in with those, because these are really very basic. So fourth one was really for, let's say, so fourth one was hard because it was really specified the database, which case is MS SQL Server, and we have been working with MS SQL, so you should answer that as well. So when you concatenate string with the number column in a database like PLSQL or TransactSQL, you'll get an error. So, and you should be, because it's not a string, it's not a number. Why you are adding string with a number? You should get an error. But for MySQL, when you use the plus sign, it really treats both sides as a number. So for MySQL, since it's a string, it will be converted to zero and will be added with this value. So what will be the case? So answer four, it's for MS SQL Server. Let's see. So MS SQL Server, you can do that. So there are a couple of ways you can do that. So for PSQL, there is a function called string, str. So if you say str and put any, let's say, date or any number, integer, anything, it will become a string. So string or varchar, as you can assume. Or there is another way to do it, which is for every database, you could use the cast function, which is very common to every database. So you have to know SQL, these basic SQLs. So how can you do it? Let's say you give a field name, and you cast it like, let's say varchar, 30. So that's how you cast any field to any type. And if you really want to have int, you just say int, something like that. So this is how you can treat any value to any type, or you can go from any type to any type if it is possible. So if the field that you're choosing cannot be converted to int, you'll get an error. So you have to be careful about that. But the string function is very straightforward. If you say just a string, whatever value is passed will be converted to string and will be added with the another string. And there is another function which is also available in every database, MySQL, Oracle, SQL Server. So every database supports that, which is the concat function. So a concat function is works like this, that you just write the concat and whatever you say, let's say you say hello, and again you say space, and you say, let's say, a number field, and you, let's say, give some number, let's say you give some date and add some space, whatever you did will just give you a string with addition of all of those. So there will be a space from this, and then the number field, whatever value you get from the number field, 1, 2, 3, 1, and so on. So this function is available across every database, and the benefit of this concat function is that when you add those fields in the table, as you can see that there are BID, some of those are null. So it's very important. I learned the null concept very harshly. I haven't read any books. I haven't found any article in my time. I just have to find it by trial and error. I was trying to get a query. I was trying hard and hard and not getting the expected result. And finally, I found that it was the null value what was really making me suffer. So the problem is when you do something like this, let's say I'm doing something like str and a field name. If the field has a null value, as you can remember from the programming, that if you have a null value to a string, it always holds the null value. Null is a different type. If you put a null value to a string, it will also give you a null value. The concept of null is null plus something is always null. That's the concept. So it's true in every database scenario, whether it is MySQL, whether it is Oracle, whether it is MS SQL, whatever the database is, null plus something is always null. So when you do that, let's say a location plus str bit, so bit have something called null in their field. So if that's the case, then there would be two fields which will be null. Okay, and the rest of those for MS SQL and Oracle, the field values will be same. But what happens when you use the concat, it gives you the only string. Let's say if you say concat null plus something, it will give you something. Okay, let's say if you give null plus something plus one, it will give you something plus one. So null always does something for the null objects. It really removes it and doesn't take it account when they are merging the strings. So concat is really very important function for every database. So when we use concat, we'll have the appropriate result that we expect. And if we use this string, we'll get null in those fields. So that's the concept. Based on this concept, there are several questions. So for MySQL, as I have said earlier, so it treats everything as a number. So when you're using MySQL, the left side becomes really the number. So in the question, when we're asking to do it with MySQL, this side becomes the zero and this side becomes the number. So for the null values, there will be no exception because we're not using any function, but we could use the concat function. If that the case, then the answer or the result should be looks like this. You could try it out and let me know if I'm correct or not. And for MS access and for MS SQL, if you just plus it, you'll get an error. But for MySQL, if you plus it, there will be no error. And for MS SQL, there also will be no error. And the result, as I've said, that null plus something will be always null. So, and for Oracle, I really don't know the exact result, what will be the plus. And if you do the plus, it will give you an error, that's for sure. But there is no share function, but when I wrote it, I thought there is. But when you were giving the exam, I was really looking for this share function in Oracle, and turns out there is no share function in Oracle. But yeah, I was right that there was a concat function which will does the job, and if you use the concat function, the result will be similar as MS SQL. That's really given. So for the number eight was also based on that concept that I have talked, that null plus null, null plus something is null. So as you can see that since we have this one and this one, these two are string for one case, but every one of those are null plus something, null plus something, null plus something. So for MySQL, it really converts the things to the numbers when you are doing the plus. So this one only gives you the zero, but others will give you the null. Also, and there will not be the Oracle. That's the wrong choice. I put it mistakenly. It should be MS SQL and Access. For Oracle, the syntax, and it is really said in the question as well, that the syntax is correct for MS Access, MySQL, and MS SQL. MS SQL Server. So Oracle is not the case. For Oracle, you really have to use concat or have to use something like this. So this operator. If you want to just concat, you should use this. So there is no plus operator in Oracle for string addition or something like that. You have to use concat function or use this in Oracle. But for if you're using MySQL, you could use this for strings. It will MySQL or Access, it works just fine. So it shouldn't be here, and the answer should be look like this. If you have the databases, you could check it out. So for question 9, answer was a straightforward. As you can see that I have just labeled it, write the syntax. You should know that because this is a basic syntax for select a statement, and that just find the right answer. That's it. So 10 was also a very straightforward basic question. You should know that in query always converts the things into OR. So in means OR actually. So here all the answers are a bunch of ORs, but what will be the difference between the answers? Because in actually executes as a block, but OR, if you write OR are just either this one true or that one true, but when you put a bracket, it really works as a block of code. And you can see that a in have a bracket before and closing its syntax. So the right answer for this will be this one. If you just use in, you'll find that this one the right answer. You could query it out. It's very simple. If you use SQL for months, you'll find out that it's very what I can say, that it's really very natural that you see the query and you understand that these are OR. That's it. OR with the brackets. In means OR with the brackets, and same thing is also true for between. If you see a between, it's really AND with a bracket. That's it. These are block level codes. So in the question 11, I just ask you to find not null. So not null has a syntax. So if you are asked to find sometime not null, there is no way to check, let's say, if you have a field equals null or not null. This is not true for any database. You cannot check any database that where field not null, where field is null. The concept is you have to use this syntax, where field is not null. That's the syntax. Whenever you try to check with null, Remember, null is not a simple data type. It's a different data type. It will give you different results. So that's why the syntax is different. If you're checking that, if it is not null, you have to write it like this for every database. And if it is null, you should write like this. Field is null, something like this. So as you can see that others said that starts with, so if you remember for them, like example. So if you spend, let's say, 2 hours with the W3C SQL, or if you have given the question, the quiz in the W3C, you should be able to answer these 40 marks very easily, because some of the information on notes are very useful. So if you go to the like, you'll find that the examples are really given, that what happens when we start with it or ends with it. So it's really given. The three of the like commands are really given, and how you could invert the like and something like that. So these are really very basics. So as I've said, that starts with, so if you have a starts with means you really say something, and this is the starting with, so starting with O and C, and then you really don't know what will be the characters are. So you put a wildcard sign. That's it. So some databases wildcard sign is star, some databases wildcard sign is percentage. So it should be let's say field like OC. So let's see the answer. As you can see that here I have given the full answer, where star from A, where bid is not now, and a location like OC star. And you can see also the star wildcard example was also given. And in the question number 12, it says that not started with LOC. So started with LOC and put the not in front, as I've shown that not is also given in the examples of W3C. So if you have a spend, let's say 3 hours, you should be able to answer these questions. So yeah, this one is really straightforward. So next one says that 13 started with LOC, it's the same question as 11, but there is no not now category. So as you can see that 13 was exactly same as 11, but there is not now, because as you can see that most of the questions are very straightforward in the basic section. If you know basic SQL, you could answer those. So the 14 number was a puzzler, because there is a small thing which says doesn't contain. So whenever you see that contains anywhere means you're blank at both sides. So anywhere means you have to use the like in both sides. You have to use the wildcard in both sides. That means anywhere. So whenever you see that it says search for anywhere in the field, you have to use this field like. So answer, and it the question also says that does not contain, so you have to put a not in front of the whatever query you are making. So here the query is the percentage OC, so that's the query, and it says doesn't, so that's why I put the not in front of it. So question number 15, it says that what would be the big O when you're searching against primary key. So it's really from the video that I have given, the conceptual layers of database, or the foundation of databases. So a primary key is also known as the clustered key. So clustered keys are sorted in the database, and the best searching algorithm is always executed, which is the binary search, since that was sorted, the binary search was executed. So each time you have a primary key, it's really always sorted. And for sorting the databases, they use something called radix sort, which is a very fast sorting algorithm, which really does the sorting in n times. No one sorts does in n times, but the radix sort does it. Radix sort does something like this, that if you always have something in their own indexes. So as you can see that if I zoom in, you can see that line number one contains the number one, line number two contains the number two, line number three contains the number three. So this is called the radix sort. So whenever you delete a row in a database, it's really gone, but the number they never really remove. As you can see that if you have a primary key or index key in database auto incremented, most of the time if you delete the one of the primary key from the middle, it really never removes the index. It really keeps the index, and it keeps their index so that it could sort in a way that radix sort works. But if you have a manual manual numbering system, in that case they have to use other sorting algorithms like quicksort. But in most cases, that's the case. So if you don't have a primary key, if it is any field, the sorting searching is always big O N, because you have to use the linear search. Well, sometimes there is hashing also, but if you're not asking for top one or only selecting one row at a time, it will always take the order of n. That's it. So number 17, it really describes in details that how it really works. So number 17, big O, find big O against non-cluster index. It will also form the video. So cluster index, as you can see, as you have learned from this, that are really sorted. And again, if this is a primary key, it is really sorted in order. And let's say I have another field, which is first name, lies something like this. So I'm using the examples from this, let's say. So okay, let's say something like that. So what happens is this is the cluster index or the primary key, which is sorted. So if you make another index, let's say this is PK, let's say you make another index, and whenever you make another index, that another index is known as non-cluster index. Another index is known as non-cluster index. So that's the term. So what it does is the pure database remains the same, but it also saves another entity of the table in the background. So in that sense, it really saves like this, that it sorts based on the first name. So since the first name is another index, so based on the first name, so the alliance should be on top, so should be in the middle, and should be there. So first name, and your PK is also there. So for alliance, PK was 4, for Azhar, PK was 3, Mahadi, PK was 2, something like that. It may not be this order, but it may be more random, let's say 2, 3, whatever the case is. In this case, we're not interested in the primary key. So if you make another index, which is known as the non-cluster index, will also be saved something like this. So there will be two entities for every entity every time you enter a row to the table. So what it does is, if you search now, since it's sorted, you will get the search result in log n time, which is really very faster than order of n. And what it does is, if you search for Azhar, it will give the result in order of log n time. It will give the result in order of log n time, and order of log n time is really less than order of n time, which is really very faster, So after finding that, it picks up that primary key, and that primary key location, it knows that where it is, and then finds the whole row by that primary key. So it's really advised not to make every column index, because if you do that, every time you enter data, it will have to sort, and for sorting, it will take at least n log n, the best sorting algorithm, if you think about it, quick sort. So that's why you shouldn't sort, shouldn't keep all the columns as non-clustered index. You only make clustered non-clustered index when you have users asking for the same column, let's say millions of times, or if you have a heavy traffic and most of the users are looking for the same column most of the time, then you should use the non-cluster index. Otherwise, don't do that. So, as I've said, the best sorting, it was also answered. So, for non-cluster index, adding a new item, you have to use the sorting. So, they use the best sorting. So that's why it's n log n. Primary key. So a number will always perform better than a varchar. So that's why the composite keys are very neglected or avoided in modern database design. Because whenever you make a composite key, you have to make that key as a varchar. So if you really think about it, if you let me give you another example of our university IDs. So our university IDs are something like this: 1120 821042. So first two really represents the year, and the fourth one represents the semester, and this one represents the role, as you can see, that role, and this one represents the department. That's it. So rather than putting it as a number, if you put it as, let's say, varchar, so each varchar characters will take 8 bits or 1 byte. So for that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9, so you are 9 bytes, so 9 into 8, 82 bits. You're almost outrun the bigint. Bigint is the biggest integer type, which is 8 bytes. And bigint could hold 18 to maybe 28 digits of numbers. So here you can see with the 8 bytes, you can save 18 digits of number, but since you are taking it as a varchar, you can only save 9 digits of number with 9 bytes, which is a very waste of your space. And it really performs worse if you have millions of data in your table. So that's why you should always try to keep a number or a grid. Grid is a data type that was explained in the database designing video. So grid, which will perform better than varchar. So that's why the composite keys are very voided in modern design. You should do that, do the same thing. So next one is about the n-char. So n-char is something, n-char or char. So you have to know that what n means. In SQL, MS SQL, MS SQL, in char or in varchar means the data type is Unicode supported. So you know what is Unicode is. So normal ASCII 2 supports 0 to 255 characters, and which is only 8 bits for one character. One char equals 8 bits, and if it is a Unicode character, one Unicode code char equals 16 bytes. So it could hold any character in the world. It could hold Chinese, it could hold Japanese. That one character could hold every language's character in the world. So you have to know what is Unicode is. So n varchar or n char really means the that this type supports the Unicode. So if you want to write Bangla or want to save the Bangla in database, you should use n char or n varchar. So it was really there with access from 2000 after 2003 version, but it was really very surprising that Oracle doesn't have Unicode support around 2004 or 2005. So it was really very devastating. I was designing a database for a company with a Bangla operating system, Bangla typing system, and Oracle couldn't do it. And then around maybe 2008 or something like that, later on, they started their new type called Varchar 2. For Oracle, Varchar 2 means it's Unicode, and again, Varchar means it's non-Unicode. That's the difference. And for MySQL, Varchar means it's Unicode supported. So the difference between nchar and Varchar, nchar and Varchar is really written here. So in terms of space, nchar or char or varchar all takes same space. So if you have a varchar, let's say, example, if you have a varchar, let's say 8, and if you have a char 8, and if you have a n varchar, let's say 8, if you have a n char, let's say 6, so every one of those, let's say, make 6. So if you really save hello, hello have 5 characters. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you save 5 characters, so you should save, you should have a space left for one character. But it doesn't. Whenever you declare a varchar, it's really fixed length. In database, it always takes 6 bytes. So it will always take 6 into 8, 48 bits, plus 2 bytes for pointer. That's always in every database. Most database, there is always an overhead of pointers to locate the data in the database. So for char, it will also be same if you save hello. But the difference is with char or nchar, you'll have the full space. You cannot trim the space here. For varchar, if you save hello, it will save only hello. But in char, if you save hello, it will also save the space here because you chose to have 6 characters. So whatever length you choose, it will always fill that length with a space. It will also take the 6 bytes, so 6 into 8 bits, 48 bits, plus 2 bytes for pointers. So 2 bytes means 2 into 8. So nchar, for nchar, it would be 6 into 16. For nchar, it will also be 6 into 16. So that's how the nchar and char works. Sorry, nchar and varchar works. The explanation also given here. So to find that, you have to, since it's a 8 8 byte, so you have to put 3 spaces here in a where clause, or you could use the like syntax, like clause. So for 21, okay, so it was also straightforward, but it also depends on database to database. For Access, I use Access for many years, Microsoft Access, and for Microsoft Access, between doesn't give the exact result that you are looking for. In most cases, what we really want in between, that whatever the condition that we gave between, say condition 1 and condition 2, so what we really want is condition 1 is greater than equal, and condition 2 is less than equal. So whatever column you are comparing, field, so whatever column you're comparing, it should be greater than and should be less than. That should be the case that we expect. For luckily for MySQL, MS SQL, it really treats like this. There is no problem with it. But for different purposes or for different databases, between command acts differently. So that's why there is also a point that it varies from database to database. If you choose that, it's also correct. So the answer is, so another thing very confusing here, you can find that many of those are having the same condition, but what's wrong? Here, AID is given, but here, not AID is given. So you have to give the AID. Always you have, when you are comparing, you really can't just say and less than something like that. You have to specify the AID here as well. So the correct answer is also D. So all the others have a syntax error. So we're on number 22. So 22 is very straightforward. It's really given. The question is also given in the answer. So we're in, let's say, yeah. So 22. So I have written in a big informative way, but it's really a single line of code. So this is the query that we're looking for. This is the query. Select a star from employees where birth date not, since here I've said that not between, so most of you have missed the not, I have seen it. So not between the date, that's it. So some databases expect you to write a hash in front of dates, so I missed the hash here. So some databases like Access, I have worked with Access for many years, you really have to put a hash in front of dates to compare or anything. And another thing about the date is not a string. Date is something like number, and date is always represented as a number, and they have something called an int part and a fraction part. The fraction part, they save the time, and the int part, they keep the days difference or date. So how it keeps, in Microsoft Access, they have something called ideal date. So I'm not really exactly sure what's the date. It is something around 1841 maybe, or 1831 maybe, something like that. And 31 December. So whatever the date is, the ideal date you can think of, that's the date that computer thinks that it's a zero. So after that, if you pass one day, it will count it as one. If you go before one day, it will count it as -1. So that's how the first int part was generated, and the second part is somehow divided by the 24 hours and then give the fraction of time. So whatever date you pick, it's actually a number. That's why you could perform dates as less than, equal to, and so on. Since between varies from database to database, it's not really a good practice to use between when you're not sure. So best way to do is just check it like this, greater than and less than, something like that. So some databases expect to have a hash, but Oracle, MySQL, or MS SQL doesn't require to have hash sign. So comments, you could write comments in two ways. In most databases, both support it. So one is a double hyphen and then put a space. That's important. Double hyphen, put a space. So whenever you see a box, it means it's a space. So as you've seen that in previous question, I have three boxes. It means three spaces. So okay, so here comments. So multiple lines, you could have a slash star and comments and slash star, something like that. So that would be your answer. So for answer 24, so 24, it's really highly said that only based on table ABC. So I think the most confusing part is here that the cross sign, but other than that, everything should be fair and square to you if you have doing SQL. Some of the questions are really not very easy, like this, the string addition, that one, and some of the results that I have asked there. But other than that, most of the basic questions should be straightforward and easy to answer for every one of you. So cause this should confuse you, but for MS SQL I know, but others I really don't know. So I should put MS SQL there. So for MS SQL, cos, sine, theta all works just fine. You just put cos and any number, it will execute and give a number. We never use it, but they do have a function and it really supports it. But you never need to use it. You may be confused with that and you could put it as a wrong, that I can understand. But other than that, every one of those are straightforward. This one is also fine because I'm comparing, I'm taking BID, which is a number, as a string. That's it. And plusing with another varchar, as I've said previously, that you could do it if you have a function like str. So if you're confused with it, you should put a question or answer like this, that is it for this database or something like that. So that's when I understand that you understand the concept and now you're not sure that which database that I am talking about. So if you're not doing that, that I understand that you don't have idea that how it works. So I will give you a zero for that if you put it as wrong. So it's also a correct answer, and this one is wrong because BID, B doesn't have an ID column, it has a BID column, as we are following the convention that the table name plus ID, that's our convention. So this one is wrong, and this one is wrong as well, as you can see that ID column is wrong. For, and this one is also wrong, BID is wrong, and this one, okay, so this one was interesting. So I'm selecting from A and C table, so if you go to the C table, all are given here. So you go to the C table, so I'm really selecting from C table, CSCID, CN1, CN2. Selecting from C table, and I'm saying here AAID equals to C dot BID. BID should be a primary, should be the primary key of B table. Here we're selecting table C, and here also the ordering, also the wrong. So as you can see that, that's why this is wrong. And this one is, let's say, okay, so this one is correct. The top one means return one row. And as you can see that here I am saying top only supported by Microsoft SQL Server. And if you have used limit, some of you have used limit, I have seen in the answers. So when you're using limit, you should say that it's MySQL. MySQL supports limit. The only database supports the limit, but others don't. You have to do it by top in MS SQL. In Access, you don't have a choice, and in Oracle, you also don't have a choice. You have to select all of the data that you are getting. So that's the case, and for 25, okay, so for this one is also looks fine because we're taking the information and ordering it B.BID. So let's take the answer. So yeah, J is correct. So incorrects are E, BBID, yes, this one, and this one, as I said, that EF, and G, and H. H was wrong because I'm selecting BID from C table. H, and that's it. So 25. It was also a straightforward query. The returning 5 rule, that was a challenging part. So if you're writing for against MySQL, it should be limit 5. If you're writing against MS SQL, it should be top 5. That's it. Other than that, it's just a straightforward query. And here is another thing about the group by. Whatever column you put in here, you should put it in the also group, since you were using aggregate function. So that's the concept for basic queries. So these are very, very straightforward. You should know this. It is also, the answer is also given here. That's what we really need. You just put AOID into AOID, since you cannot use that square function right away. To use that, some databases have a power function, but if you don't have, you can just use your common sense and make this query right away. So here we're seeking for this one and the distinct, because we have asked for unique ID, and unique ID mostly and unique ID for one column. And as far as I remember, that unique ID or the distinct keyword can be only used against one column. I don't remember that you could use it for multiple columns, but if you can do, just give me an email. But as far as I remember, that you cannot use that. So substring, that was a very interesting function. As I have said in the group, that string manipulation was a part of the exam, so you should know substring, replace, uppercase, lowercase, something, and so on. So if you write one database example, I was just fine with it. So in MySQL, you could declare a variable like this, select and at sign variable name and put a colon and equal and the value of the variable. So what substring does is substring, you say a string and give the number where it should starting from. In programming, substring starts from 0. In databases, substring starts from 1. So you have to remember that that's the difference between programming and database programming. So 1, if you say that 3, and the next portion is always the length. So if I say 1 and 3, it will give a starting from H and give me 3 characters from that. So if I say starting from 2, give me 3 characters, it will give me ELL, 3 length. So it is same as same in MS SQL as well. So the answer should be select concat, since we're adding it with okay, so 27, right? So yeah, it's a given example, maybe. Yeah, it's a given example. So the right answer should be, let me check that what I really asked. Okay, and add then with BID column. So after you add it with the BID, so yeah, you have to use the concat because it's the common function available in every database. It's the safest one. So substring allocation starting from 2, I have said from index 2 to 4, so 2 is starting from 2 and length is 2, so we'll get to the 4th index. That's it. And the same query will be for true for Oracle, MySQL, MS SQL, and so on. So now we're in the advanced part. So advanced part, let me go to the image. Describe it from the image, that would be better. So first one is really the intersecting part. And intersecting part is also known as the inner join. And inner join is also same as join. That's the concept that I want you to understand or know and put the things in here. If you know this, it's just, let's say, 1 minute's task to solve this problem, which gives you 4.5 marks. So L minus R, which I have said clearly, L minus R. So is there any L minus R? So in database, you could say L minus R by L, not R. R, not L. So that would be placed for 2. So for 1, it should be intersect, inner join, join. For 2, it should be L, not R. I. Okay, so for 3, I'm taking the whole part of left. So if you know or familiar with the left join, so in left join, you should have the left part at least once. So whatever the left table you are getting, you should have all the items from the left. And left join and left outer join is the same thing. So these both should be placed here. And for the right one, it should be the right join and right outer join, which gives you the all the column, all the rows from the right join table, right table. And R minus L, which is also be the I. And here I have said that L cross R, and I also do remind that full. So sometimes if you have common in both places, it really gives you the L cross R product, which is the full outer join, J. And union is actually this one. Or it also refers to the full outer join. So if you just go to the answer section, you can see that I have also said the full outer join is this. So let me go to this one. Here queries are a little bit tedious, but here's 7 queries. But if you figure out only 3 of those, you're fine. As you can see, the results is only 3. So whatever or however you pick, if you just generate, you have to understand the synonyms as well, because full outer join is a different thing. Left outer join and left join is the same thing. Right outer join and right join is the same thing. Inner join, join, and this where is the same thing. So you have to know this. If you're doing SQL or practicing SQL, that should also be familiar, because join was in the syllabus. So in the full outer join, so I have described some of the things here. So what happens when you do a join? So join always gives you a Cartesian product. So if you say AB cross CDE, a join will always give you a Cartesian product, something like this. So a full outer join, when you do a full outer join, let's say you have these columns and these columns. Let's say, for example, and this is not the exact representation that you should get, but let's say that, yeah, this should be, because this column should be here, DID, and BName should be here. That's how you'll get the exact representation. But other than that, it's the almost same representation that you'll get after doing full outer join between these tables. Full outer join, any join. Okay, so based on the join, it gives some conditions, and the Cartesian products, as you can see, that I should take the first one, and against that first one, I should repeat all the rows from this table. So as you can see that one, I'm repeating one. When this one is 1, I also have BID 1 here. 1, 1, A1, this is the repeated thing, first row. And for this, I have B1 and BID 1. And the next one, I have the same thing from this row. And then I have the next row from this table. And so on. When I have 2N and A2, I have B1 and 1. Next time I have 2N, A2, B2 and 2 from this table. And it goes on and on. So when you say at last that A.AID equals B.AID, it only selects those parts which are really common. In this case, that AID and BID are same. So as I said that, sorry, it should be. So here is a glitch in the answer. So if you just go to the table, you can see that there is also AID portion. So it should be repeated as AID there should be another column called AID, and whatever AID we get based on this one and this one, if those are matched, then these rows will be selected. That's the concept of join. So a full join always includes both table rows. So if you do a full join without any where clause, so let's say you do a full join, select a star from, let's say, table one, full outer join. You write the join name and then you write the next table name that you want to join with. And you could give an alias like this, a table name as D1, or you could just say table 1 space D1. Whatever you say after table is fine. But whenever you're renaming a column, you should put S. But when you are renaming a table as T1, T2 or anything else, you could put S, or if you don't put AS, it is just fine. So then put that table 2, and you could also give an alias to that table name. And then finally you should write on. That's very important. Then you write the condition for joining. If you do just that, a full outer join will give you a result where both tables T1 and T2's all rows should be included at least once. That's the concept behind a full outer join. At least one. But if you give a where condition, then that would be different. It will filter that based on that. But in our second question, we just ask for the joining, that if you understand how the joining works. So at least once. So what will be the answer for that, the first one? So take a look. So let me go over to the data. That would be much more better. So here's the data. Here's the question. Here's the question. So first one says full outer join. So that, as I've said, that it should include both tables. So this one and this one at least once. So as you can see, that B name contains a B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. And A1 contains A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. There are spaces, but the consistency is same. So you should look for a result which have these two things at least at once. So as you can see, that the clear choice is A1, A2, A3, but do we have A4? So should have A4. So here the first result doesn't contain A4, so it fails. So come to next one, it contains A1 to A4, but B1 to B4 is missing. So clearly this one is the choice because it has everything A1 to A4. As you can see, that A1, A2 are repeated. It could be repeated, but it has to be A1 to A4 at least once. As you can see, that here is also the B1 to B5, but yeah, B1 to B5 and A1 to A4. So this is the clear choice for full outer join. So let's go to the answer. Yes, the result is 3. So it was also explained there. So left outer join. Left outer join is also known as left join. So how left is declared. So if you write a query like this, star, so table 1, and whatever join you write, so let's say left join for simplicity, So left join and left outer join is the same thing. So whatever you write, whatever in the left is known as left table. What is on the right is known as right table. So what happens is, since we're doing a left join, we at least need the left table. So we just go to the code. So left outer join. So left table is a table. So whatever result you choose, you should have a table's results at least once. And then you are joining a.bid equals b.bid. For this type of conditions, whatever conditions are given, you should look for the smaller one. So a.bid. So you should go for a.bid first. So you go to the A table, should go for BID. And next, you should go for the B table and you should go for BID. So in B table, BID has a long list, 1 to 5. But in A table, BID has a very small list, which is only 1. You should take only the distinct version of it, or unique version of it, which is only 1. So the result is very clear. You should have all the results from table A, which will conclude A1 to A4, including which matches the result of BID1. So you should have B1 and all the items from A table, which is A1 to A4. So what will be the result? A1 to A4 and B1 at least once. So this one would be the result. So next one is the right join. So again, do the trick. The question, see the right join against AID, again B.AID. So you have to go the tables and look for AID first here. It has 1 to 4, so 1, 2, 3, 4. But in here, AID is less than this one, so 1, 2, 3. It has really less. So since it's a right joins, so right side table is B, you should have B1 to B5 at least of once, and you should have the joining of 1, 2, and 3 of A. So 1, A1, A2, and A3 should be in the result. So what would be the clear choice for that? So B1 to B5 is there, so no other table have B1 to B5 here. So A1, A2, and A3. Is there. So that's the result. That's it. You're done. So finally, the inner join. Inner join only gives the result which is common in both sides. That's the concept. So in both sides, the join, So I'm here in the data. So in an inner join, you have a condition that says that a.bid equals b.bid. The conditions are same for all the inner joins, as you can see that where is also the inner join. So a.bid, so BIDs should be same. So when the BIDs are same, so as you can see that in A table, we only have one BID, which is only 1. So only BID 1 should be connected with this. Since BID is repeated here 2 times, so BID 1 will be linked in these 2 places. That's it. That should be the result. So in this case, this would be the result. So that's how you generate the results. But after guessing those 3, you should get the last 3 part. So this one was a little bit hard, and I didn't expect to write it at once or learn it from this 1 month. But it is very important to understand, and that's why the question is given. And the question is given so that you could learn it after the exam. So other parts are easy, this one is very hard. So how to really do it? You have to understand few of the things. to answer this question. So we never save age in database. So why is that? So let's say currently my age is 21 years. So next year my age is going to be 22. So each time, each year, or maybe any day of the year, someone's age could be added or will be go to the next level, you don't know. So if you just keep the age 21, at the next year, at the same date as my birthday, you have to update that plus one. So it's really very costly. So we don't really do that. Instead, what we do is save the date of birth. So from the date of birth, you could generate the age. So how can you do that? In programming, there is also functions to do that. In most databases, there is a function called DetDiff. Okay, so DetDiff is very popular from Visual Basic 6. So some of the things from Visual Basic 6 is very common to every database system. So DetDiff. So what DetDiff does, it has three parts. So first part is the which one I said, that which one you want to choose. And the next part is the start date. Start date, and next one should be the end date. That's it. So which one is actually referred to day, month, year, second, minute, and so on. Dot dot dot, so on. So in MS SQL, we have a same function called DetDiff, which also accepts this part. So which part? So in this case, we want to have the age. So in this case, we're saying the year, but it will not give any fraction of year. But in the question, I have shown you the fraction of year. So to get the fraction of year, what you can do is get the month per se, and after getting the month, it should give a start date, which should be the birth date. And then you should give the now, or be the current date. For MS SQL, to get the now, you should use getDate function. It's a function which will give you the current date in your system. Exact current date, minute, second, millisecond, whatever the clock is ticking at your machine. After that, you'll get the month's difference from the date of birth to this date. So if it is if it gives you a minus, then you place the dates in wrong place. So whatever I do in programming is always forgetting it. If it is giving me a minus, I always into it with a minus one. So in database, you just read the manual, but you have to know this, that how it works. There are some functions you have to know. So it will give you a month, and after getting the months, what you can do is divide it by 24 or 12, and you'll get the year and save it as age. So that's it. Save it as age. So for MySQL, there is something called time stamp diff, which also works same as date diff. So birth date, and rather than get date, you just say now in MySQL. That's the function. Divide it by 2 and save it as age. That's it. That's how you will get the age as same as I have shown here. And the next thing is, or another thing about the MySQL, that MySQL also have a function called DetDiff, which always give you the difference between the dates. So in this case, if you say birth date slash comma now, it will give you the day difference between the date of birth to current date. And in Oracle, so in Access is also same Access, but in Oracle there is nothing like the date function. In Oracle, what you can do is date 1 minus date 2. You should Google it how to do it. I really don't know. I haven't done it in Oracle, but something like this should work for Oracle. But since it's really asked for MS SQL and we're working with SQL, MS SQL, you should know this. But once you know in one language, if you know one language, others are really piece of cake. Our purpose and of the exam in most cases are MS SQL, but we also tend to ask other questions, other database concept and questions, which really differs from database to database, where you could remember the things which will give you the flexibility of switching the database at any moment. So after saying that, what you need to know is about how to do the uppercase. In the question, it says that do the uppercase for the first name. It's really given in the display section in the left. So upper, you can use the uppercase function, or some databases it says uCase. So uCase also supported by MySQL, or supported by Oracle, but I really don't know if it's supported by MS SQL or not. But upper also supported by MS SQL, Access, and so on. Access. So upper is does is whatever field you give, it will give the uppercase. That's it. So another thing you need to know, that you need to remove the UL from the string, what we get. So it should be replace. Replace function is always same. If I'm wrong, correct me. But as far as I'm concerned, it should be the same as what I'm writing here. So if I'm wrong, correct me. I'll be happy to be corrected. So could use upper, say, since upper in MySQL also works upper, so use upper, it's better. So use upper and say field name. In this case, our field is the first name, so we'll give you a first name with the uppercase. And now the in replace, after giving the first field, should write the first thing that you should search for. In this case, we're searching for UL, and we're removing the UL by empty string. Just put it empty. That's it. So that's the part you're done. So how to do the all things? So first thing, I really need to have first name and then concat it with the last name. So we also need a concat function with the last name, and I should have a gap between first name and last name. And then I want the age to be written in my first name and last name. So age should be written. So to write the age, I also need a space and a bracket. So as you can see the pattern here. So that's it. After getting the date, I also have to enclose it with the parentheses, and I'm done. So I'm done with the first part, which will be as name. And then I also need the second part, which should be the age. And you cannot put an age there and call it in another column as here. It will give you an error, so you really have to do it like this. You have to again say that MS SQL age, and then we're done. You just put some enter so that useful to understand that whatever we're doing really meaningful. So this one. Age from the table is employee. Then where I also said that age must be greater or equals to 20, and age must be in descending order. So order by age descending order. That's it. That should be your full query. If you have any more question, mail me. I will go more details. So we're in the fourth question. I have seen most of you suffer from this type of question. So there are some easy tricks to find out the right answer. So to do that, I will give you another example, real life example, which is really shown in many websites. So here I have Google spot the difference and find an image and show it to you. So let me spot the five differences. It says that spot the five differences. So problems like this has an easy trick to find out. So first thing you should look for is the place that no one should ever look for. So first thing that I should look for is somewhere really in the eyes or in the ears. So if I go into the ears, I can find that if I compare those ears, as you can see that it has two dots, it has three. So here's the one difference. If you go to the eye section, because no one is really looking at the eye. Everyone will look at the shoes or something like that, this place and this place, or the cloud, something like that. But no one will look into the eyes. So if you see the eye, that this ball has a light ball, but this one doesn't. So this is the difference number two. So in next, I will go for the left ear, but in this case, there is none. So in the next section, I should go for hand, because no one should look for the hand, because it's the last place that you should look. So in the hand, as you can see that this tree is there, but there is three, there is only two. So that's the difference number three. So what is the other differences? As you can see that in the front, it has these two are white, but this one is black. This is very noticeable. So this is number four. And number five, as you can see that in the top. But in most cases, these type of problems, the spot differences never shown in the top of the picture. But in this case, this is very flat, so you might miss it. So this is how these concepts are designed, that you should look for the places that no one should look for. So let me start with the question. So for SQL type question, you should first start with the conditions. So whatever conditions that's given, you should write it down. So the first thing is it should be in ascending order. And next, it says that the rating should be greater than has an average rating of 2, so greater than or equal, has an average rating of 2, so at least 2 or more. So written in every subject and display, it's important that which are the fields that I want to display. So book ID, book name, and book ID, book name, and display rating. So I should have these fields in the display. I should have ascending order. I should have a condition which has average rating greater than 2. So this should be the condition. So to compare those, what you can do is copy line by line code. So first thing you should do is write the first five codes in the same line. and spot the difference. That what's the difference there? Since you are in computer, it's really very easy to copy paste and find out the spot the difference. Okay, so I think we can rule out one just right now. As you can see that in the question it says that average should be displayed as display rating. So fourth one should be just crossed out from the first checking. So now we're left with only, if you just label it with A, B, and C. And D is gone, so this one should be E. So this is it. So from this four, we again have to rule out by the next line of the code. So next line of the code is from. So do it very quick. If you could spot it right away, it's just fine. But I think this way is better, where you can clearly see that what's wrong with the code. Or you could do it better like this, that the first one is there, but you just put the next line there. Sorry, the next line should be this one. Copy it. So this one should be there. And number C. And we don't have D anymore, so we should go for the E. Okay, so in the next case, from condition, as you can see that not all of those look same. Not all of those look same. All of those has R, but this one has missing R. But in the selecting case, I'm really selecting for R.bookID. So first one is really ruled out. So now I have only three. So it's really very easy for me now to pick which one should be the answer. So B, so now copy the whole line. After doing all this, I will go to the syntax or the condition. So another thing I do for those questions, I really first check the conditions, if that those match or not. So if there is any greater than condition, I really check those out. So in this case, the greater than it has a less than condition, so it should be ruled out at first. But since we're doing logically or step by step, so I didn't do that. But the first thing I do for this type of questions is check the first condition, greater than or less than, if it doesn't match any of those. So in this case, we could rule out that D at the first case. But I'm going step by step, so put the where for the B, so where for, where should be, so where is B? So okay, so here, if I spot the difference, this one is looks fine. So if you spot the difference between those, have the similar type of conditions. So just put the and, just zoom in. So spotting the difference, book ID. So you can see that like the there might be a condition with the Dr. Ramesh, so which are might be written by Dr. Ramesh, so should be another condition that I miss, so I should write it down. So dot 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 means that I should have a like there, because I'm not sure what is after the Ramesh. So it should be something like this. So the query should look like something like this. This should be the exact query. So here, as you can see that this one also have dot dot dot, but dot 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 actually in the context really means that the percentage with the like, as you see in the context as before. So if we don't remove this right away, let's take a look what happens. But this one is clearly not the choice, since we have S and then space then H, which will give a different result in a query. So this underscore means whatever character could be possible here. So that wouldn't be the case that we want. So C is also gone. So we're left with B and E. So since I'm doing it very gradually, so it's really taking some time. But when I do it, I just take out the line by line very quickly in pencil and paper, which give me a very efficient result very quick. So with B and E, so let me go to the next two, three lines just right away, because there is none left. Okay, so let's spot the difference. Okay, so clearly the group by has only one, but this group by has two. But is it correct or this one correct? That would determine the final answer. So here, in the case that we really want these fields, so we have book ID, book name, and average rating is a aggregate function, so we don't need that in a group. So whenever you use an aggregate function, AVG, max, mean, sum, grade, count, something like that, whenever you use at least one aggregate function, other columns should be in the group section. So other columns is book ID and book name should be in the group section, but here group ID is there, but not the group name. So this is not the answer. This one clearly the answer. So that's it. Maybe it's not defined that details in the answers, but this is how you can find it. So the answer is also given there. The SQL we did earlier. Okay, so yeah, the B1 is the correct answer. Like doesn't satisfy. So I did some mistakes there, but yeah. It also says a syntax error. Another name is less than, so I did it by the less than sign, as I've said that I first checked the signs. And author name should be in like. Okay, so there is also the group problem. So if you just go by the rules, you will find the things very quickly. So for this, SQL select, so again, you have to go really like this. So rather than spending the time, you get my point that how to really do it or how to really find this. And the answers are really given here. And there are some explanations that, well, which of the things, because I spent a lot of time to do that at the first place. So I'm not going to do it for this next one as well. So sixth one, answer six. For answer six, for question six, go to six. So here I have said that try to be smart. If you have any answer already given, don't try to answer it again. So you have to check the syntax, if the syntax is correct. So yeah, it seems the syntax is correct. So if you declare the alias, you should have all the names with that alias. You cannot write like B here, or if you have an alias something like that, what I meant to say is if you have a query like this, so it's an alias A alias, A alias, let's say, and B. So if you have an alias, you should write the alias there. You cannot say B anymore or A anymore. After declaring an alias, you should give the alias to everywhere. That's the concept. So for correcting the syntax, I really meant by this, because it's just a basic join command. So here, as you can see that in previous examples, I really said that a.aid equals b.aid. So if you go to the join in previous, say inner join, okay, so we did it with bid, so here we have a.aid equals b.bid, but here I'm saying that not. So not means actually, if you remember from the first example, so whenever we have a join, it actually gives a Cartesian product of those both tables, and if you have equal condition, it will only give the results which are equal to each other, which is actually the inner join. But if you don't have that equal condition, in this case we have the not equal condition, then it will give all the parts which are not equal. And to express that, if I go there, so in this case, this is not the right one. It should be AID, and the which one, the equal, if you say AID equals B.AID, it only gives the items which are equal to each other. So when you say not equal, it will give all the items except those items which are equal. That would be the result. But since in the question, here is something called the not. So not is actually divert the result what you are getting. It's really inverting. So it says not equal, so if we invert it, you will get the equal. So it's really the inner join. So to have the inner join, you just write the common parts between those tables. So to have the common parts, I could really say right away by having another text path. So really based on AID and B.AID. So AID, AID. So when you have a join, as I've said that, take the minimum part which have the minimum number. So in this case, 1, 2, 3. So 1, 2, 3. So here, 1, 2, 3. So both should have the common parts. So to have the common parts, you should write like this, that selecting tables, selecting table names. Okay, so this one. So AID one should will give you B dot AID of, that's a one. Will give you A one, give you B dot one, B one. So for number two, so again, we have to use 2, because if you see that this condition, this has more rows than this one. So if you choose this one, it has the 2 next, and for the 2, A2, it should choose this A2, and this should be A space 2, and B should be B2, and for next time, the AID in the B table is also 2, so you should write 2. For 2, we have here 2, and A is also 2, but B is here that 3. And for the next one, let's say that this one, if AID is 1, and the AID is 1 here, so if you have 1, this should be also 1, and then A should be a 1, and B should be B4. Then again, we have one gone, so we have three here. For three, we also have three here and A space three. For three, we have B5. That should be the answer for the query. So if we just run it in SQL Express, should have the same result. Okay, so let me make new query. Okay, so I can just run it. Okay, so it's really wrong about it. Okay, so there should be a.aid. So, yeah. So, see the result. 2213, 12213, a1, a22, a1, a3, and so on. So you'll get the idea that how these questions are answered. So, rest of those are really the same thing. In this case, this one is really one of the inner join that we have declared earlier. So a.bid, it's the inner join that I remember, I've seen a couple minutes ago. So this one, a.bid, b.bid, so this one. So here we are getting an error in the SQL because AID is common in B table and A table. When you have common things in both table, you should specify that which of the things that you want to select. You have to select it by the table name or the alias name. But since you have declared the alias, if you just say AID, it will be wrong. As I've said that once you declare the alias, it cannot go back. You should have to declare by the alias name. That's the concept. So, the next thing is, yeah, there is a syntax error, as I've said, that it should be a tab, since we have declared the alias, and the query should be the rest of the things except the inner join of the Cartesian product, so it should be there in the answer. Select 26, so one, two, two, okay, so 3, 1, same thing. Yeah, same thing. So 7, it should be the inner join that we have discussed. So that would be the result, A cross B, without the matching. So it's really straightforward. You just have to go multiplying those and have the result. So and this one is another inner join, which really refer to this 7 number question, which has a not really inverse what we are getting. So this one by not is actually the inner join. So number 10, I'm really very lazy. It's really 5:30 in the morning. I really lost all the juice, so I'm not going to write the query all by myself, rather I'm just showing you what I've written. So here the conditions are really straightforward conditions. So first thing that I did, that I write the conditions first. 2 months ago, haven't rated yet, have 4 authors, so authors have wrote one book in the past. So it's MS SQL. So whatever I have to select, I just wrote it in the top. So from book, aliases B. So I'm doing a join here. It could do a left join, which will give you the exact results since we are getting the all the results by the last where clause. So whenever you get the results by the last where clause, you could use either the left join or right join. But for left join or right join, you'll get the query over all the rows from the left, and on the for the right, you have the query from all the rows from the right table. But inner will only first join the things that match, so you have to remember that. So if one table have no value that you're joining, then your whole result will be null when you're joining with inner join or saying just the join. So that's an important concept. So whatever table that you are joining, if it doesn't have any value, the whole result will give a null value. But if you want to have results, let's say if you have books, but you don't care if there is author or not, but you really need to see the results, you should choose the left join. So rest of the things are straightforward. Join, book is joining with author on, then saying where it should join, book ID equals book ID. And again, I'm saying join. You could join multiple times. It's really simple syntax. So how can I do it? Select star from, let's say, table one, D1, join. Should name the join name. It should be it could be left join, full outer join, inner join, or whatever. So you should write the join name and then table two on D2 as alias on the condition of join. And if I just put it in the next line like this. So if you again say join, it means join with this table as well. So it's just fine. So table 3 join condition. You could also say left join, let's say T4, and so on. You could also join from same table with a different alias as well. And you could also change your join syntax. Let's say these two are inner join, and you could have a left join here as well. So it could do joins like this. So then after doing the joins based on the condition, I just check that the book is written 2 months from now or not. So I use the date diff function, put the month, publish date, get date, and if it is 2, that means the book is 2 months old. So that's the first condition. So I divide the conditions so that I understand that which one should be going to where. So where condition only takes, there is a difference between where and having. So having only goes for aggregate functions like avg field name greater than equals something condition. And let's say max, so something like that. But where goes for any other field condition. Let's say field is greater than or equals to 1 or something like that. So where goes for only fields condition, and having goes for aggregate function query. So we have aggregate function query, which is have 4 authors, so that should be done by count aggregate function. So having count authors more than 4, and authors should be linked with book names, and also by grouping by this shouldn't be there. It should not be there. should be by author name, because there is a design problem in our system. So it's a many-to-many relationship. It should be a many-to-many relation, but here we have simplified it by author name and book ID, which is a problem in the design. If you think through, my brain isn't working right now, but it's really for your assignment, and it will be a question in your next exam, so be prepared for that. So that one was really something, what can I say? Should be in different table and join with many-to-many relationship. That simple. So next one, if we just go there. So it shouldn't be there, and other than that, everything is just fine. So count and sum rating should be zero. Have not rated, so rating should be zero. So that's the condition that we're putting in the where, having, and the condition that related to the fields are really given in the where clause. That's it. So that's it. This where should be removed. Somehow it's really misspelled. So we're in the 11th question, which may be the before the last. So you just go and execute those. I'm really too tired to explain those. And these are really very straightforward, and it's really explained. The last question was really explained that how it really works. If you just, it was really given. If you know this, you could write stored procedures very quickly, and maybe one of the videos have a stored procedure how to write it in SQL. So the basic idea is clear. Here is something like if else logic. So if else logic, and top gives the top one row. So first time I'm giving the same as XP and YP. There is no syntax error, by the way. So XP and YP are same in first case. So, but if you check out the descending order, since it's saying that descending top gives you the number of 3, ascending gives you a number of 1. So we're in the descending order in first case. So number 3 will be in both number. So if XP is 1, it's not 1, but XP and YP is same, so it will give you a founded. So the result would look like something like this. So result, 3 equals founded. So next one, selecting top one where AOID is 1, and this is also in ascending. Ascending will give you also the 1. So 1 and 1 will be equal, so found 1 will be true. And the next one, this is in 1, this is in descending order, descending order gives you a 3. So none of these will be true, so it will give you a not found result. So if you run it in SQL, see that it gives these 3 results. That simple. So that's it for the session, and happy coding, try to learn more. And if you have any questions, email me, and that's it. Thank you. Goodbye.